Greetings and welcome back to room 303 AP English, our Roberts Lectures. We are in the poetry section and now we turn to Henry Reed's Naming of Parts. Few poems have been able to have the powerful longevity as it relates specifically to statements about war, wartime, and the effect that war has, especially on the young. One of the reasons for this, I think, is because of the brilliant way that this poetry is constructed, this poem, in relationship to the voice, or put it in your notes, it to be the voices, because there's multiple renderings of how we'll read this poem. Now, Reed's dates 1914 to 1986. He was a British poet, translator, radio dramaticist, as well as a journalist, and he did serve in military intelligence during World War II. So in other words, he knows whereof he speaks. And this poem is going to remind us a lot of other kinds of poems that we sometimes will refer to as either war poems or pacifist poems. You get to choose how you want to read, obviously, the poem. Let's pay attention to the voice or voices of this poem. Naming of Parts, the 1946 offering. Today, we have naming of parts. Yesterday, we had daily cleaning, and tomorrow morning, we shall have what to do after firing. But today we have naming of parts. Japonica glistens like coral in all of the neighboring gardens. And today, we have naming of parts. This is the lower sling swivel, and this is the upper sling swivel, whose use you will see when you are given your slings. And this is the piling swivel, which in your case you have not got. The branches hold in the gardens their silent, eloquent gestures, which in our case we have not got. This is the safety catch, which is always released with an easy flick of the thumb. And please do not let me see anyone using his finger. You can do it quite easy if you have any strength in your thumb. The blossoms are fragile and motionless, never letting anyone see any of them using their finger. And this, you can see, is the bolt. The purpose of this is to open the breech, as you see. We can slide it rapidly backwards and forwards. We call this easing the spring, and rapidly backwards and forwards. And rapidly backwards and forwards. The early bees are assaulting and fumbling the flowers. They call it easing the spring. They call it easing the spring. It is perfectly easy if you have any strength in your thumb, like the bolt, and the breech, and the cocking piece, and the point of balance, which in our case we have not got. And the almond blossom, silent in all of the gardens, and the bees going backwards and forwards, for today we have naming of parts. Now the genius of this poem is that Reed is going to postulate that during one activity, another activity is, of course, taking place. I mean, come on, guys, this is very similar to what we're doing right now. The old man's up here droning on about poetry, and your mind possibly, well, let's not even say possibly, is somewhere else, right? And until a poem like this kind of reaches out and grabs your concentration. We're reminded of T.S. Eliot's Bert Norton, distracted from distraction by distraction. And every once in a while, a poem will reach out and kind of grab us, and we think with more urgency about what actually is this poem doing. And I like to say it that way, what is this poem doing? Not so much what it's saying, but rather what is it doing? Notice we have a polarity, a dualism at play. We have the instructor who is obviously walking them through the different parts of a rifle, the naming of the parts. Then we have a young man whose voice is going to represent something else, something way more profound, we might say, something more natural, something more beautiful, and then obviously something profoundly lacking, right? As we have this juxtaposition between the two. In each stanza, we'll have some instruction. Notice we begin with time. Today, yesterday, tomorrow. We think of T.S. Eliot's four quartets, Bert Norton's time present and time past, or both perhaps present and time future contained in time past. all time is eternally present, all time is unredeemable. What might have been is an abstraction remaining perpetual, possibility only in a world of speculation. This notion that we're beginning with time, in other words, these young men are being taught how to take care of a rifle that will ultimately either save them or not save them, depending on its use, and obviously the other side's learning the exact same material. But then notice in the first stanza, juxtaposed to this, we have this beautiful nature imagery, right? Japonica-like, glistens like coral in all the neighboring gardens. Then we'll have some more conversation. Notice that sight comes into play in the second stanza, whose use you will see. Then down later in the fourth stanza, it's you can see as you see, this notion of sight. In other words, there's two kinds of sight in this poem, right? There's the sight of looking at the rifle, and of course, let's make sure we appreciate the multiple uses of the word sight on a rifle to aim, as so many of us know, because we spend time with rifles, right, up here in our country. That notion of the sight helps one to be able to place within proper distancing whatever it is that one is shooting at. Notice in the third, in the second stanza, the branches hold in the gardens, they're silent. Notice the use of the word silent. Eloquent gestures. And then in the third stanza, notice there's this interesting order as request, and please do not let me see anyone using his finger, right? And then, of course, the idea of the blossoms are fragile. The use of the word fragile is compelling along with the word motionless. The next stanza will play that game of sight one more time, and then rapidly forwards, backwards and forwards, the early bees are assaulting and fumbling the flowers. There's been a lot of reading of what this line is suggesting, that maybe nature is in itself, of course, always at tension. We think of Darwin, don't we, in Origin of Species. And the notion that then nature doesn't really take a side in regards to conflicts that are war-like. Finally, of course, easing the spring. The word spring can have multiple meanings. Not only is spring as in a catch at a rifle, but also, of course, the spring that is a silent spring. We think of Rachel Carson's classic Silent Spring, don't we, at the conclusion of this poem. That is to say, there's going to be a whole lot of the gentlemen, the young men, who are listening to this instruction, who will not make it through the altercation that is coming. At two-way messages, well, obviously, war damages so many things. The young, nature, the world of hope and expectation, right? That is to say, the parts of the rifle are somehow counter to nature. They are unnatural, we might say. And then obviously at 2A, nature refuses, as we said, to take sides. In war, all of us somehow lose, tragically. At 2B, notice I began by suggesting that we have voice or voices. I think we do have voices here, and I think Reed's poem is genius for it. And obviously the tone is as well powerful here, right? Notice, how do you motivate young men? Will you kind of scare them a little bit or challenge them in terms of their manhood and their strength, right? I want to see you using your thumb and not your finger, that kind of thing. But then you have the second voice that understands what true strength is. True strength is the ability to see that nature has its course. At 3A, well, there are so many texts that come to mind, from Lao Tzu's The Tao Te Ching. Of course, we've given lectures on this for our World of Ideas lectures, to Richard Ebert's The Fury of Aerial Bombardment, which we've already studied. We have lectures at LearnStrong.net on The Soldier, Rupert Brooke's offering, which gives you another view of a voice, a patriotic voice about war. Siegfried Sassoon's The Wirers, and we have a number of Sassoon poems on LearnStrong.net. And of course, Wilfred Owen as well. Anthem for Doomed Youth is one that immediately comes to mind. But I want us to focus finally at 3A and relationships to other titles with Thomas Hardy, The Man He Killed, a text that is a part of our study in Roberts. But the reason I point it out is because Henry Reed studied the work of Hardy, wrote his thesis on Hardy, and I believe that strongly that is standing behind this offering. Finally, of course, Steve Spielberg in Saving Private Ryan gave us a moment in time to be able to understand and appreciate the horror and the hero-like quality of the young men who landed on the beaches at D-Day. How does that all relate to this poem? I'm going to leave it to you to think about that. Finally, at 3B, how can you relate to a text like this? I'm noticing that as I'm speaking, some of you are sobering. It is a sobering, isn't it, question. What is your view on war? Sometimes war is necessary, maybe, to stop a horrific bad guy. We think of Hitler in the Second World War, and yet the way it affects so many things, how has it affected your family directly and indirectly? So many of us having family relations who have been participants in wars of one kind or another. Of course, it affects our civilization too, doesn't it? No question. And we, of course, study so many texts that have to do with war, from the Iliad to Vonnegut's Slaughterhouse-Five and everything in between in a poem like this. I hope the reading of this poem will lead you to more of Henry Reed's stuff. Amazing poet. Thank you.